Before we actually start with going through the different UI components, I first want to tell something about the Dataminr Integration Studio. So the plugin that we're going to use. I already told you that years ago, we were typing all those XML tags ourselves. We will see during this module that we also have snippets, also some plugins that we already had a bit for having complete blocks of code that we wanted to include, but now we have the Dataminr Integration Studio, which made our lives easier. I'll mention how it made our life easier during the features that I will approach. So, first some installation and license things, briefly introduction, and then I'm going over the main menu, top menu, and some features. And at the end, demo. During the previous modules, I didn't show in demo, but it's easier if I show it you step by step when we actually are going to create our protocol. Then I'll show you a complete hands-on demo. So installation and license, what do we need? We need a DCP account for the people who didn't have one. Jordi came by for creating ones. So normally you can have each moment now an email from him that your account is created. That makes it possible to download the DIS installer, where you can find it. If you go to your DCP account, which will be mentioned in the list how you can access it together with your credentials, then we can go over here to software downloads. And there we have the DIS. You will see also other downloads like the latest supported version of Dataminr, etc., that you can download. But now we're going to concentrate on this. And we have a main release and an insider release. The insider is just with already new features available, but not yet validated by our quality assurance team. The moment it's validated and we know everything works in the most or in every situation, we create a new main release version for that one. But it's already possible as a customer to already make use of the insider builds, but sometimes can go wrong. People who work with Windows insider builds will also know that sometimes functionality doesn't work anymore. So after you have downloaded it, you can then just double click on it. If you have of course you first need to have a Visual Studio installed. One note, it doesn't work with the free Visual Studio. I don't know the name of it anymore. So commonly we work with the Visual Studio Pro, but there is another one, but it doesn't support plugins or the plugins that the Dataminr Integration Studio needed. So if that isn't the case, it's also always possible to download the trial version of 30 days, I thought, of the pro version. So that's one that we need for this. Then we have the Visual Studio. This is in there. What do we then do? We connect with our DCP account. Don't worry, the first time it will fail, but that's just so that we know on which computer the DIS is installed, so that the license team can activate your computer for the account for your computer. And so that's then the part requesting license from SLC, that just replying to the person who sent you the DCP email about your account that you have received from, it's not working yet, and then he will activate it, and then you have a complete operating Dataminr Integration Studio after you have restarted your Visual Studio. Maybe it's good that the persons who didn't have it already trying this, so that we can start this afternoon with playing a bit around with Dataminr Integration Studio and Visual Studio. If something goes wrong with the installation of it, don't hesitate to ask me, then we can have a look together.
So if you have it in your Visual Studios, you should see it at the top, right?
Yeah, there's a different tab area or something, and that
I have DIS, but then what? You go to DMA and connect, or
Not yet. The moment it already starts up, then you have a valid license.
Oh, okay. So I have...
Because at the startup of Visual Studio, there's a license check. And the moment you can see it at the top, it means that you already have a valid license, else it won't be available, that plugin. So what do we have? We have our third-party device over here. We want to retrieve data from it by using a data miner over here, creating an element. We define which protocol we want to use, so the XML file. And then we have something additional, but we'll see that at the end, for debugging. So this Data Miner Integration Studio supports live debugging by using the debugging tool of Visual Studio. So that means that we are only allowed to use the debugging feature in our own network. It's not possible for remote debugging across a VPN connection. Not as far as I'm aware of, but based on topics from Visual Studio, it wasn't yet. Maybe in the later versions, but currently not for security reasons. And then we have the Data Miner Integration Studio. So that will run on our Visual Studio environment. First of all, the basic what we have is a protocol editor. So for defining our timers, our groups, our parameters, and much more in there. And next to it, we have a display editor. You will see that we can easily drag and drop our parameters, our tables, and other things on pages that we can create on the fly. We have a table editor for easily adapting the width of columns, for easily replacing the position of a certain column in that table. Like, remember that I was talking about the display key, that I don't want it to have the first column, I wanted to have it at the very end. No, with the display editor, we can just take it, drag and drop it, very end, while before we need to make the adaptations and the XML code itself. For small tables, that's possible, but sometimes you had tables with more than 180 columns, then it's already a bit hard for 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, it's that one. And a quick action editor, but that's something that I will briefly mention during this module. I'll come back to that on Thursday when we're having a bigger look on quick actions.
For the debugging, you mean we have to be on the same subnet?
Yes. Yes, on the same network. Yeah, you must be able to connect to the agent itself.
Now we have to work on Google Desktop and the agent himself.
But the thing is, we have a data miner on our own laptop running, on which we can test. We also have immediate communication with the device. Then we can debug and see what's going on in the quick actions for sending or getting information from the device. Sometimes it's on another server that can access it, like the agent that we are configuring is on another server in the network, then we can have a remote debugging enabled. I can show you there's documentation about that. That's with a Visual Studio program that you run on the other server so that it's communicating with you. But therefore, still, you need to be in the same network, like or your user needs to be allowed to log in on that other server, or you need to have the administrator password. For now, during this course, I'm only going to do it on my local PC to just give an example, because if we all do a remote debugging on the server that we're going to use, then it gets stuck. Because, for instance, if I debug it and I attach to the ESO protocol process, for instance, then all that process is stopped because I'm looking into it. Other users who are working on that server can't do anything anymore because I took a lock on that process. I attached my Visual Studio to that process.
So maybe to implement the workshop, we should install data miner in our own computer?
Yeah, but normally the debugging, I'll quickly show you how you can do it. It's very easy. It's done for you locally, remotely. I refer you to the page in the data miner help, where step by step you can see how you can do it. But during this, during the workshop, I'm going to show it how I can do it locally, because I have a data miner installed on my own PC. But I'll mention during the steps what you need to do differently if you're going to, if you want to use it remotely. Okay, step deeper. So we have our DCP, we download the disk plugin, we install it, and then we have our key features. Easy development, because it's easier by just having IntelliSense in there than just writing the whole XML thing yourself. So that's already one major advantage that we have right now. Easy navigation. It's possible that you have a visible parameter in there that you can immediately see in which group it's linked or in which groups, because it's always possible that a certain parameter belong for some logic reasons in multiple groups. We have the different editors, like the display editor, the table editor, debugging that we can do with our own Visual Studio, that we can see what is going on. Validation is also possible. Real-time validation, like it detects if we have a duplicate ID given to a parameter, so no duplicates are allowed. It gives a warning. And we have also an integrated MIB browser in the plugin. But I'll come back to that step by step. The MIB browser is something that I will briefly mention, and more details will be given tomorrow when we're going to communicate with an SNMP device. So at the top, we have our tools, tool windows. For in case you have a Visual Studio with this opened, I can show you where the next slides are going over. So we have over here at the top this, so Data Miner Integration Integrated Studio. And then we have tool windows, outlining, generators, DMA, etc., etc. And those are the things where I'm going to talk about right now. So one of the first tool windows that you have, and that's already a very important one, especially for us to use, we have our protocol tree view. So remember, we had our root tag protocol. You can see it over there at the top. We have our name. So this is an exercise SNMP example now. Appropriate description that you immediately exercise on working with SNMP device, the version, provider, vendor, etc., etc., etc. All this information, the header information, is immediately visible in the protocol tree. Next to that, we have the different subcategories that we have implemented in our protocol. Like at the bottom, almost completely at the bottom, we have our timers over here. We have our groups and we have our parameters. Immediately next to it, you'll see the amount you have. Like in our case, we only have one timer, we have one group, and we have 8 parameters. But what do we also see? We see parameters of the type read over there, like system description, system uptime, system contact. But we see another system contact parameter with a W next to it. That means that's the write component from it. Remember that I told you that we have different types of parameters depending on their functionality. We have a parameter that only will read the data from the device, and we have a dedicated parameter linked to the read one that will send the data to the device. So the write parameter in our case. Those numbers are the IDs that you gave them. So ID 1, 2, 3, 13, 4, 14, 5, 15. And you'll see that everywhere in your protocol tree. At the bottom, some additional info, like you see over here, we have selected our system info group as an example. Here at the bottom, we see outgoing, that means which parameters are in there and the content of it. So the content tag contains the parameter system description, system upname, system contact, and so on. So the parameters that we're going to ask the data from the device itself. And we see incoming information, that means in which content is the group used, and we see it's used in the timer system info. System info, a timer that gets executed each 60 seconds. Do note, it's not possible for us to provide all information of it on the protocol tree. I mean, there are still some attributes like fixed timer, initial true, false, etc. that we can't show in there because we only show the XML tags together with the value in there. Also, it will get a bit flooded if we show every attribute in there, but by just clicking somewhere in there, you immediately go to the correct thing in your driver. That's something that I can quickly show to you. So, already some slides in front. It's possible for me, or no, I have my examples over there. I'll show it later on. Example SNMP, for instance. It's in here, so then I can say tool this tool windows, I want to have my protocol tree view. I have it over here. I'll just change it a bit to light out. So just drag and dropping and then place it where you want. I want it to have the full window like here. And then you see this. So name, if I click on it, I immediately go to the name and it's selected. The value of it is selected. Provider, Skyline Communications, element type, training, example type, display, SNMP, auto, and so on. I have my port settings that I can look, my timer, more information, if I open things, and my parameters over here. So just by selecting one, I immediately go to the XML in my document. So that's one of the key features, one for easily navigating. So that's one of them. Another one is protocol mappings, so that you have a clear overview of what is available in your protocol. So like we have the different sections, the subcategories, params, actions, comments, groups, pairs. Some of them are used for serial communication. I'll come back to that next week. Timers, etc. And just by clicking on one, you see here, you see here the parameters that are available. That's also something that I can quickly show. So if we go this two windows protocol mappings, it came available on my first screen, so I've just ended it in here. I can hear.
Do you know where we can find like an example protocol to navigate in the lease?
Normally the examples are added in your Visual Studio project. But the thing is, you can open such a, this afternoon we will make exercises. The thing is that we start from scratch. You always have the solution in there. So the complete solution, I mean, of the exercise that we do is in there for in case you want to see if there where it went wrong or something. But it will be the intention that we start from scratch, because then it's also better for me to guide you for where the problems are and maybe give more explanation, because sometimes I'm saying things that are convenient for me, but that I don't know that it is something completely new, because already working years and years and years on such driver is like, oh yeah, yes, we have RT display true, of course, only RT display true, and then you have trending enabled, but it's normal for people for which the first time that it's a bit more advanced.
Also follow the typical order when developing a driver, like firstly you do the headers and...
Yeah, but before we start with our hands-on this afternoon, I'll give a quick example where I start from scratch. Now you'll immediately see the full thing in here, but I'll start from scratch so that you can see how we can start with creating protocol. So by default, it's indeed filling in the header, but more of that this afternoon. So over here, if you have the mappings, I can select here the parameters in there, and here I see the different ones again. It's another way of navigating to it, because we also have a bit of that in the protocol tree. I can select one, like my system contact method 2, for instance, and I was expecting some information in here, but apparently not. Or it's more when I select a group. Not really. It's a different way of navigating. I don't know, maybe that's... I guess then that's an UI issue that we still need to fix over there. But it's a different thing in which you can easily select the data that is available in your protocol. Going to close this one. We have our disk inject. I'll come back to that one later while we're going to, when we're working with quick actions, then I can show an example about how disk inject fits in there, but that's the debugging part that I told you. Next to that, we have a complete MIP browser in there. So it's possible to load in MIP files and then just drag and drop complete parameters from the MIP of the device into your protocol with much of IntelliSense already in there, but sometimes you need to adapt some things.
The MIP browser is only for SNMP?
Yes.
Okay.
More of that tomorrow during the SNMP course. And also we have a protocol grid view. That's a complete overview of everything that's in there. It's actually very nice because due to the sorting, you can do lots of things with it. Like, if I demonstrate this. Yeah, no, I only have only 8 parameters, but you can sort it by instance, by ID, by name. You can apply some filters on it. So like, I only want to see my read parameters in here. Or I'll disable that one. I only want to see the ones with trending. Currently, no one has trending allowed or configured because it are all string parameters over here. Like you can immediately see route type, other type, string, and so on. Like the units, this one has degrees in there. Those one are types. Which types do we have? That's something for this afternoon. Those one are titles that we display, but that's a UI component that we will see this afternoon. So also sorting on name, etc. So that's possible with the grid view. Outlining. Also, I'll just immediately show it with an example. Like I have this over here, and imagine that you have a very, very big driver. You can say, I want to outline this. So this outlining, you see there are also some shortcuts, Alt 1 till 6. Those are in different levels. Like I can say, I want outline at level 6. You see at the 6th position of the XML deep level, it's outlined for, to make it more clear, I'll just outline at level 3. I see my big groups are available, params, but everything in there is collapsed. Same for group. If I just outline at level 1, yeah, everything is in there. So, for instance, I just use Alt 2, and you see the big groups are collapsed. Yeah. Even when it's collapsed, it's possible to expand the ones again, based on the level. So I can say I'll do it on level 2 that I have that, and I say, oh no, I'm losing too much information. I want to do it at debug level 4, for instance. Just press Alt 4 or I go to this outlining 4, and then this is the result that we have. Also do note, hovering over something that is collapsed will show you not always everything, but a part of it over here. Oh, it's gone now. But you don't always have to open it just by clicking on the cross. on the plus and minus sign, or just double click on it and it's over there. Next to the outlining, we have the DMA itself. So we can have a connection with the DMA, like if I just close this one. So I'm connecting to a remote computer and I don't have any protocols on my own PC. So what can I do? I need to add something in an already existing protocol. I'll say, okay, first I'll make a connection to my DMA. That's something that is defined in the settings. I'll come back to that in a while. So for instance, I'm connected to a remote one now because it's connected. I can say I want to import a protocol. So now over here, I see a list of all my protocols that are available on the system on which I'm connected. So then I can say I want to open Exercise SNMP version 1.0.0.1 and imported it in my Visual Studio environment. And it's over here. Sorry? So this DMA import protocol. Do note that this just doing a change in here and just hit the save button won't adapt the protocol on the server. This protocol is saved somewhere in an internal folder. If you want to know why, you can easily click on the above tab page and say open containing folder. Then you see it's stored in my app data local temp. It's just because we don't want, if we by accidentally hit the Control S combination or save the document, we don't want that the server immediately gets updated. For in case we made some mistakes in that protocol. So it's possible to import it. Publishing it as something else, but I'll come back to that. So the import of a protocol, like mentioned, generate helper code. That's something, remember that I was mentioning in quick action that we have created helper classes to make it easier. Like if you want to get information from a parameter that you don't need to define the ID, but that you can mention the name of the parameter. So we had our name, which is internal logic, and we had a description, which is external logic. So for the internal logic, the name is also unique so that we can refer to it. And that we can use it inside quick action because it's more readable to say, okay, system contact equals Jens, for instance, instead of parameter 1 equals Jens. When reading, like in the beginning, it's nothing. If you have a small driver, you say, okay, I can easily scroll in my protocol tree having a look, parameter 1, okay, it's my contact name. While the moment you're going to develop bigger and bigger drivers, it's like, okay, going up parameter 1 and few lines further in your quick action code, that's parameter 5003. Yeah, scroll. Okay, that's over there. If you then have lots of such parameters, like for instance 20. Oh God, what was parameter 1 again? Scroll. Okay, it was that. Previously this was solved by putting next to the parameter that you get inside of it and comment what's the purpose of the parameter, which one it was, but nowadays we can just use the this helper classes, which makes it lots easier. But that's something for Thursday. Then the settings, I'll just immediately going to show you them in the Visual Studio environment. So what do we have as settings? Generate helper code, yes. I explained the concept, but not what it does. Generate helper code is, for instance, if you have some quick actions open and you changed a name. Do note, we only change names of initial drivers. So very first one, not a driver that is already running at the customer. We never change names because that can have an impact on their system and we don't want to break it. So we only change names when we see over here current version 1.0.0.1. The moment it's in use by the customer, we don't touch it anymore, unless specifically requested by them. And that's something that I will mention again and again and again during the implementation of things, and the pitfalls, because a small change can break a lot. Even if you say, oh, it's only a description of a parameter that I say, like instead of audio output level, that we change it to my audio output level. But it's possible at for us, for just testing only this driver, so only this typical device, it won't change a thing. But if we having, instead of just device integration, have a look on the bigger picture of system integration, it's possible that the customer already have alarm filters working on that typical name, or dashboards or reports. And the moment the report wants to have want to ask audio output level and it doesn't find it, yeah, you have empty reports. And because it doesn't know, oh, it has suddenly changed from audio output level to my audio output level. So this is something that I will bring up a few times. But for in case you're working on an initial driver and you have changed it and some quick actions were open, you can click on generate helper code so that everything in the quick action logic is refreshed with the new names, that it can detect errors. But because sometimes when it is open, it's possible that it is still linking to the old name in the cache. It's actually flushing the cache and recreate it so that we can have the linking correct again. But that's something that I will show you on Thursday. Few minutes to go. Okay, so the settings. What do we have? In here, currently I'm connected to my local host. I can change that by filling in an IP address or a DNS name to access another cluster in my network. Again, not possible to access immediately a data miner agent through a VPN network, because the data miner integration studio plugin use the framework of Visual Studio, so its features, and Visual Studio doesn't allow it to connect immediately across VPN, so we can't override that. Use current Windows user. Imagine that you're working on a general shared computer. Mostly then you need to fill in administrator and your password. You have some debugging options. So by default, DLL import locations. Mostly we use the DLLs, of course, that are delivered with Dataminer. So the two commonly folders are Skyline Dataminer files and Skyline Dataminer protocol scripts. You have the possibility for remote debugging, but I'll show you that at the end of this week during an example, so that you can enable that. We, of course, then we need to have a look at files in the remote folder. We can't use our local folder for remote debugging. Interface, some additional settings, scroll and mouse cursor. By default, disable C# syntax highlighting in all XML documents. What is it? We will see if I just quickly import a quick action one. Exercise quick action, this one. So you see over here, my C# code inside the quick action is gray. But that's something that we did with this plugin, because before that, it was always enabled by default. And it's possible that I need to reload it again to have this. Import quick action. You already noticed maybe that loading was already taking a bit longer and I only have 3 quick actions. Imagine that you have a protocol with more than 20 quick actions, then it takes a huge while to have those colors, etc. also in there. So by default, we say, our setting is to have it disabled, but of course, you can overrule that one. Also some additional ones, but in the help file of the Dataminer Integration Studio, you find much more what are the features are and how you can configure those. I'll just close this one again. So interface, the MIP, if you load the MIP, the default location where you can store it, because each MIP that is loaded will be stored on your PC for compiling it. You can have at your company your own MIP store on which other things are located. That's defined in the XML. This help will explain you how you can overrule that to change the folder where you can search for such MIP or save loaded modules. DCP, so you can log in with your username. And the reason for that is for automatically checking for updates. Like here, check for plugin updates, so of the disk, and get if you want to have insider builds, you can check this checkbox for that. You can always click on check for updates to immediately check if there is an update available, but normally this will be get pushed to you by Skyline. So each time there is change something, Skyline will push an update to you, and then you will see somewhere here at the top, so we have validate, refactor, etc. And then here at the top, there will be a button available, update with three dots behind it that you can click, and then it will install it, but you have to restart your Visual Studio afterwards. Yeah, some other settings like hide warnings about UTF-8 encoding, typically when we load the protocol because of this header in the beginning, it will throw a warning. You can check this to ignore it, and some info, which version you have and the license agreement. So if I just have a quick look, I'll handle these ones, and we have the help at the end. But now we're going to do a hands-on. The first thing that we have available also is at the bottom, we have a protocol tab. I mean, under the protocol tab, we have a validate option so that we actually are going to look in the protocol if everything is configured correctly. Some warnings or errors are already immediately presented on the fly, like a duplicate ID, but like some things, like in this case, an unexpected RT display true is only mentioned when we hit on the validate button. So in there you can already see if everything is configured or implemented according to the guidelines that we provide with Skyline. Currently this isn't possible yet, but there will be a moment that you can just click on the error. So you know if because it's in the error list that you can double click on it and go to the code part where it goes wrong. But there will be a moment that you can click on there, right click and go to more explanation why it is wrong. That's something in progress. Next to the validate, we have the refactor. So if we come up with a new XSD, so an XSD is something to compare your current XML structure with. So if we redefine some names, like make it more appropriate or suits or something, we can use the XSD or the refactor so that all old values are immediately adapted to the new values. Like for instance, I remember in the beginning the attribute values were all in capital letters. At a certain moment, we changed that to small letters, like following the MSDN guidelines, then by just clicking on refactor, all capital letters in an attribute were changed to small letters. The display editor, something very useful. It just not only drag and dropping parameters on the left hand side over there to here the region. So first of all, we have one big region over here, that's your element card layout, that's one page. On the left hand, you define the pages, like you have general, encoder, FM, PSI, and so on. And then for each page, you can add parameters on there. You can even tweak them a little bit, but I'll show that during the demo. And just here, you see all available parameters. The parameters in light gray are ones that are already assigned on a page. If they are black font, then it means that it isn't dropped anywhere on a page yet. So in here, it's easy to put parameters on a page, but also for changing their position. Before we had the display editor, we had to do it manually. But imagine that we had to we have created a driver for a customer with 20 parameters on one page in the same column. We have feedback, that parameter. We don't want it on position 17, we want it on position 3. So, okay, we change the parameter of position 17, we change the row to 3. But that means for all other parameters, 13 or 14, I guess, in between, we also need to add the plus 1 so that it's shifted, else we have two parameters on top of each other. And sometimes that was a very big list to do. But now with the disk, it's just dragging, dropping, placing there, and we have it. And everything in between is adapted accordingly. So this is already a nice feature that we have. Later, after the display editor, a few years later, we had the table editor. Remember that I said this morning that sometimes we have big, there are big tables with lots of columns. I had once a column of 180, a table with 180 columns in there. And then suddenly I had to change the position, change the width of one column to make it more readable from a width of 120 to 150. But yeah, if your column is on position 70, you can start counting until you're there and adapt the width, and hopefully it's the correct one. While over here, you have on the left-hand side your different tables. Then over here, you see the how the columns are defined in the array options. So here we're working with IDX linked parameter ID, sometimes a linked right parameter ID, but I come back to that later on. And here we can change the description if we want. We can add if it is displayed or not, and we can add and type. Additional options, but that's something when we're going to talk about tables more in detail. And then over here, the displayed column. So that's actually, those are the changes done in the measurement. Here you can define the layout. Now you see 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But it's possible that I can say my index column, I want to put it at the very end of it. So I can just drag it and drop it at the end. Or the width, for instance, I can just put it on 0 if it doesn't need to be visible in this case. Also, the measurement itself of the parameter column in there and the sort type can be adapted in there. So sorting based on integer or some sorting based on string. String, for sure, string parameters can normally only be sorted on string unless, and that's already that I mentioned for later, if you have a table, the index column must always be a string value. That's the only thing that data miners accept. If you use a number, it won't accept it. It must be a string value. And the reason behind that is for writing into the database, because the database accepts string values and not integer values. So far for the table editor. Then what we have, we don't type everything ourselves. We have snippets for that. Like if you already saw the complete protocol route from the beginning, it's not that we start typing the copyright thing, etc. We have a snippet for that called protocol route. And actually, it's already a bit intelligent, being that it marks some fields that need to be filled in. So if I just go back to my Visual Studio and I say, okay, file, new. I want to create a new file. I'll select an XML file, for instance. Open. I have a complete new file in there. I'll just start over here. And what I can do now, right click, insert snippet. And then I have some snippets over here, data miner snippets, this internal and other snippets that are from Visual Studio itself. We're interested in the data miner snippets. And then you see your snippets for action, comments, group, quick action, parameters. I'll come back to that the moment we're going to have a look at each group separately. But first of all, I'm interested in the protocol route. And you immediately see here on the left side that they already have no name, description, version, etc. My params placeholder, my params block, my quick actions, my groups, triggers, action, timers, port settings. This is the basic layout and it's already in there for you. The only thing that you need to provide is some info, like the copyright year. So we're 2017, it's already filled in. Then over here, vendor X, for instance, my vendor is example and my device is called SNMP device. Just as an example, of course, device type, what are we going to poll? If we poll an IF table, it will be an interface manager, for instance. Current version, I start with a brand new protocol. So we start with, as Skyline developers, with 1.0.0.1. If you want to rename that to version A, version B, you're free to do it, but every Skyline developer needs to follow some rules. And I'm going to explain later what those rules are, because it's also important if you retrieve a driver from Skyline that you know, created in this range, so it means that there was a major change somewhere, or a firmware update, or something else, so it's very important. If we create a driver at Skyline, we all have an integration ID, unique number, for now, because it's just an example driver, I leave it like that. The date, like today, we are 11th of December, and the author, for us, it's important to know who worked the last on the driver. I'll just enter my credentials, my initials. Provider, if it is a driver coming from Skyline itself, you will see over here Skyline Communications. If it is one made by another customer or by a customer, then normally the name of the company of the customer will be in there. Vendor OID, dependent of the device. For now, I'll just place, for instance, 10, and it's the very first device that I create for that vendor. And I can say, type, which type will it be? By default it's SNMP, but we have other ones. As an example of the intelligence that you have available, like if you just put backspace and then you hit over there control space, you see a list of the supported ones over here. Somewhere of them, so currently we're going to handle SNMP normal. Tomorrow we'll see what's the difference is between SNMP, SNMP V2 and SNMP V3. It's not, one and two aren't that different. Three is a bit encrypted communication. And next week we'll see the other ones. Serial, serial single, smart serial, HTTP, and so on. It's also possible to have a virtual one. So an element that you just create without communications, but that's something that we'll handle at the end. So as an MP, everything is filled in and I can just say enter. And I already have, in a few clicks, the basic layout of my protocol, in which what contains already a lot of it. If I now go back. So next to that, so next to the snippets and when showing a hands-on, later today, in which I will start a basic protocol from scratch, I will also use the snippets and show the different methods that you can use, because when I started here, we had the snippets frequently used, but now there are different ways for entering a parameter into your protocol, so I'll try to explain them all. So next thing is navigate. One of the best features is navigating through it, also different ways. And going back to my Visual Studio. Currently, I don't have any parameters in there, so for a moment, I'm going back to my previous exercise. If we have a look, like if I go, I already showed you that I could navigate by using the protocol tree, but it's also possible, like here I have my first parameter system description. If I hover over this icon, I can see, okay, it's part of a group. By just clicking on it, I go to that group. It's the same principle like I was clicking here on the system description and the protocol tree and click on, see, it's in the group over there and click there over the group. The only difference is that I can place my cursor here wherever I want in the protocol tree and that I'm just navigating in the text editor itself and that the protocol tree doesn't adapt. So I can click on that, I see group ID 1. Just to know, the licenses are okay now? Also for you? Okay, great. Now I have a group, so I knew I came from parameter 1. If I now hover over it, I see again parameter 1, but it also contains parameter 2, 3, 4, and 5. So this group contains the system info. What does it poll? System description, system uptime, contact, name, and location. You also see that here in yellow next to it. This is also a feature of this, that you can see that one. It's not possible to remove it if you try to select it. You think you can select it, but the moment you hit backspace, you greater than character is gone. So that's something in there. It's possible if you don't want to have that. Normally it's possible to disable that. Like over here, you can also say instead of the name of my protocol, I want to see the description in there by just enabling this one. But hide virtual comments and protocol if I do that one. And I restart, but I'm not going to do that right now. If I restart, then it's disabled. But for now, I always like it when it's on because I can immediately see what's in my group by just looking at it without hovering over anything. The moment I hover over my group again, I see my outgoing, so what my group is polling, what actions that my group will take. And at the end, I see my incoming, so the things that execute my group. It's possible that in group is executed only by a timer, like in this case, but sometimes it can be that also additional an action is executing the same group. This is typically done when we're doing a setting. But that's something that we will see tomorrow during the exercise. Also, the reasons why we need to repoll it and can wait on a timer base. But like here, we go to our timer over here. And then we see the groups in there. Also, something additional that I want to mention. I don't know if it's differently mentioned in the help itself, but you won't see it here in the this window. Like if you're scrolling down or you're looking something like by Control F, like, oh, I can't find my system name in the tree view. I can say, okay, system name over here, for instance. Okay, it's over here. Yeah, where is that located in my tree view? If I just click Control 1, it's immediately selected in my tree view over here. Other way can also be done. You can also have over here protocol tree and I'm interested in uptime. I see over here immediately filtered down my uptime. If you want, you can also expand all of these like system uptime. It has a name, description, information. It contains a subtext, includes, what has the includes and so on, as deep as you can go. But yeah, that's if you want to use this. I prefer it always to have it this way because it has a better overview what you have. And by just clicking on it, you can always see what's in there. Also, this work with IDs. Like for instance, I am interested in parameter 4. You see everything that contains a 4, like here. The ID 4, 14, it has a 4 in it. System contact, because it contains an OID, is an POID with a 4 in there. So everything that has a 4 that we mentioned in there. This one is mentioned because it has parameter 4 in there. Also this one because system location is placed on general page row 4 column 0. So this is now an example in which we have the position. We saw didn't saw it during the slides, but like with drag and dropping, you will see it over here. Like we have our display tag, RT display real time display equals true. And then we add a position stack. In that position stack, we can add one or multiple positions. So it's possible that we have one particular parameter on multiple pages. Why is that? Sometimes, most times, we have our parameters sorted based on functionality. Like we have a page called audio settings, we have a page called video settings, and page other settings, etc. But for an operator, it's important that they have a general page or a main view page on which they can see immediately the KPI parameters, so the most important ones. We don't move a parameter from an audio page to the general page only, we just duplicate it. It has been available on two positions. Why? Because it's a very important parameter, depending on the device. That's also why we at Skyline read the complete manual of every device that we integrate to know what is the device is doing and how must we communicate with it, of course, but also which are my KPIs that commonly are used. Also interactions with the customers to know how is the customer using the end user, how will he use the device, what's important for him. And based on that knowledge, we can say, okay, we have a main view page or a general page containing these and these parameters. All other parameters can stay at their categories. So this was the navigation. Then some quick tools that we have. One of them is if we have added a read parameter in there, that we can just click on the arrow on the left side of it over there, and that we say generate a write parameter. Then we have this window over here. And then we can say an offset by default. Well, it's 10, I think, but just changing it, update will update this one. So the read identifier of the parameter was 3, then 53, we add the write in there. Also something that I recommend with adding parameters is using offsets, because we often see, especially starters, that we add parameters. Okay, parameter 1, 2, 3. Oh, 3 is a write. Okay, 4 is my writable parameter. Okay, then 5, 6, 7. 7 has a writable parameter. 8 and so on, making an endless list from 1 till 250. Then suddenly device and everything is just under each other, like audio, video, but with no gaps in between. Then certainly the vendor comes, hey, I have a new firmware version. I extended the audio parameters. And then you're looking and, oh, I didn't left place for that one. So therefore we recommend to always try to group things together also by IDs, not leaving big gaps like I have here parameter 100 till 110 and now I start at 10,000. No, but like 100, 200, 300, and so on, depending on how much parameters there are. Of course, we can see in the future, we don't know if a vendor is going to add one parameter to a particular group or add 50, but if you already make a few things possible to adapt easily and group everything together, it's easier for you to maintain. And if someone else needs to look into the driver, he will also be very happy. If someone else needs to debug. So this is for creating a write parameter. I'll show you that one during the hands-on. Next to that, the moment we just have a parameter, we can say, if we already have groups defined, we can say include immediately this parameter in a particular group. So over there, you will have a complete list of all the groups that are in already created in your system, and you can just say, okay, I want to have it added in here, and will be added in there. Currently, it's not supported to add it in multiple groups by using this. There are other ways to do that, but I don't think that this, but this is for sure in the make, but I don't think that it's already integrated. Next thing is for a certain parameter, like we just created our write parameter, of course we want to have a trigger on it, because we need to send it to the device the moment the users click on the button. Therefore we can say, okay, generate new trigger immediately on chains, and then we'll have this one over here. So trigger, we give it an ID, we give it a name on chains of what's that, the system location or something? No, on system contact. Time, change, immediately filled in. Type, action, content, ID. So we need to fill in an action ID in there. Or we can also create immediately, based on a change of that one, a quick action. Do note, a quick action only gets triggered based on a change. So, and only of a certain parameter. We can't execute quick actions like after a group is pulled or something, which is possible with triggers, which I will show you later this week. But a quick action can only trigger on a change of a parameter internal, unless that parameter is external triggered with the same value, like an automation script that fill in the same value, then it also get triggered. But internal, it's not possible, even with the cube. The cube won't allow you to send twice the same value. It's a protection that we've put in there. So that for a quick action. But we have, if we have a parameter array, like here the table, we can just click on it at the table instead of going to the table editor and looking to the table. Someone forgot to pay the electricity bill, I guess. If we just immediately go at the table and we immediately see the table over there. So the ones over here are exactly the same like the ones over that we have defined here. And then at the bottom we have the display, how the table is displayed. But I'll come back to that during tables. What we also can immediately do is if we have the array options defined, we can say we want to add immediately a new column. And then here, like at the bottom, which is added, column IDX5, it immediately recognize what's the next index for that table. Yeah, not the table index itself, but the IDX, the position in there. And then we only need to link it to a certain parameter ID and maybe change the type of it. And immediately a new parameter is created. So normally this should be linked. So the moment you can put a tab on that one, so by tabbing you go to the next available one marked in yellow, and then you fill in an ID and it should be automatically adapted in here also. Trending by default false. You can, yeah, the snippets have trending by default false, but just placing through. It's enabled, name, description, subtext, and so on, and so on. Features for quick actions. So now we're still in the same text editor for the XML part. The moment we're going to the advanced coding by using quick actions, we're going to a next page, and that's shown over here. So you have the possibility, if you have a quick action, you can say edit quick action, and then another tab page becomes available over there, in which you can just start typing C# code. Because if you just, the protocol itself, the main file has a validation on XML. So you need to go to the C# file, so the other tab page, to have the validation on C# code enabled. And it's possible to say open all quick actions so that all quick actions immediately are opened. It's also possible to open quick actions next to each other one by one. So it's not that only one can be opened or all. You can decide that. So we already saw a trigger on a change of a certain parameter. We also have the possibility to immediately on a group level generate a new trigger after group. When have we already used that one? An after group is typically something that I frequently use in HTTP. When I send, have to communicate with a web service or something. After the group, I'm going to read out. So I'll activate a trigger after group that launches an action for going into my quick action so that I can read out the status code of my, so my HTTP status code. If it was in 201, if it was succeeded, and my response data. Why don't I immediately trigger on the values itself, on the status code or on the response, because it's possible in some cases that I have exactly the same information. And if I retrieve exactly the same information, my quick action will trigger. So therefore I have an after group to execute my logic, but we'll see that more in detail the moment we're going to talk about quick actions and about HTTP communication. Also, if you have a group created, we can immediately say, I want to include it in a timer. And it's automatically added, in this case in timer one. If you are on a group level, instead of only including it in a timer, you can also add existing parameters, parameters that you already created, but not belonging to a group. So you saw a few slides before on a parameter level, you can add it in a group. Add that one parameter to a group, but you can also say on a group level, okay, I want to quickly add or remove parameters from there just by saying add existing parameter and check the ones that you want or check the ones that you want to remove from that group. And we also have the possibility on a group itself that we want to add a parameter, but that doesn't exist yet. So generate new parameter. And immediately we see over here again the placeholder for the parameter ID. And then at top, a new parameter is entered and you can start configuring it or defining it. The timer again. Add existing group, like we have for parameters and other things, and generate a new group. So again, with the placeholder over there at the end, and then immediately a new group created over here that you need to define. Live testing and debugging, already briefly mentioned it this morning. I'll come back to that more in detail when we're handling quick actions, because it will be easier to understand. Just debugging the normal XML, it's not possible because the debugging is done on a DLL itself. And each quick action represents in the background in DLL that is created on the system. So for now, I'm not going into deep details, but I'll show you that one on Thursday. But to mention just the properties that we have, it's called the disk inject. The disk inject. If you remember, we had this tool windows disk inject. That's the one that you have. Then over here, you can select for your protocol the element that you want to debug, because your protocol can running multiple elements. It can has multiple instances running depending on the elements on your system. Like in this case, they want to debug the a team manager, and it runs the team manager production protocol. So on the left, on the very left side, we have the element status, stopped, active, post. Then we have the data miner ID, element ID. Next to it, we have the name of the element. And then we have the protocol that it is using together with the version. Remember, production, if you upload the protocol, you can decide for one particular version, this is my production protocol. Why was that again? It's possible that you create, like you have 50 IRDs, a new version comes in, you don't want to adapt 50 IRDs, version 1001 to 1002, 50 times. So what can you say? I'll upload first my initial version 1001 on the platform. I say this is my production, and the moment you create elements, you can say you need to follow the production version. And then afterwards, if you receive new versions or you create new versions, you can just say I upload it to my system, I put it in production, and all my IRDs will adapt in the background, so that you only need to do one change instead of 50. So here in this case, the production version. And then we have this window. So we can say for that one element, we can start it over here, but it's already active. So this one is not usable now. We can put it on pause, that element. We can stop it or we can restart it. These two element display cube, I told this morning, back in the days, we had also, we still have another UI interface called element display. Actually system display, but currently we can do all functionality by using the cube, so we still support it, it's still in there, but all new features are added in the cube environment, not anymore in the system display element display environment. So if you click on it, you can open the element display, or you can open the cube for in case it's not open yet, it will immediately launch it. And you can open the log file of the element. So each element will have its own log file. As something goes wrong, you can have a look in the log file to see more information. We will also see when we're creating quick actions, that's possible to do some checks, some conditions, and then write an entry to that log file. So there makes it important for us as developer, if we see based on data retrieving from the device, that we are in a situation that we can't do really anything, that we say, sorry, something went wrong, and that we have a clear explanation about what went wrong. And that's something that we can write in the logging, and then you have the possibility to have a look in the logging. Next to that, we have our quick action here in our Visual Studio together with the one that is opened. Then we have some inject actions, so we can add it to the inject. So for instance, now we only have one quick action, so it's logic that we hit on that plus icon. But it's also possible that you have multiple quick actions, and then we decide, okay, I only want to debug these three quick actions and not the other seven. It's sometimes possible that, and we will see that for sure on Thursday, that one quick action asks code from another quick action. If that's the case, like for instance, quick action 1 and quick action 2, then we need to, and quick action 1 asks code from quick action 2. If we only add quick action 1 in there, then it will skip the step. If you are in debug mode, so the method ask from quick action 2, it will just skip it, show you the result, but don't show in the method inside the quick action itself what's happening. So therefore, it's sometimes necessary to add more in them, but in the latest this version, normally it detects automatically which quick actions that you're using, and already when you add quick action 1, quick action 2 will follow automatically. Next to it, across, just to get it out of there, that we don't debug that one anymore. And next to it, an lightning shite, just because a quick action can go off on multiple triggers. We already saw during the example or during the slides that there was one trigger, but we can add multiple triggers on there for in case the logic is the same that needs to be done. That we can, for instance, distinguish, okay, it was trigger 1 going off, we add plus 10, and then we save it on another parameter. And if you have the same scenario for 2, 3, 4, and 5, then we have 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. But if you want to know what's going wrong with 13, we can say, okay, the trigger ID is 3 that I will execute, and you can click on the execute button. And at the end, we need to attach, because quick actions are running in the SL scripting process, so we need to attach to the process. And then we see something like this. For instance, like we have here quick action 1, like you see over there. It can have multiple triggers, but you can't distinguish it now from this screen. Therefore, you need to look in the protocol itself. What we do is we placed a debug point over here and then log some information. And yeah, just a normal Visual Studio debugger is in there. On Thursday, I'll explain how you can debug if you have a local data miner agent. It's always fun playing a bit with that, because you can also, there are some windows, but more on that on Thursday, that you can use to already send some comments even when they're not implemented, but asking or executing other methods even when they are not called from the run method.